35 engines, 35 engines across Merseyside, the ability to bring those appliances back into service at a particular time. For those, you know, those 5 engines to cover the day and the night time, so 24 available during the night, movement to 27 available during the daytime, sorry. From the night time, 18, moving to 21 within the revised proposals, meaning that we've got a number of immediately available appliances both day and night to reflect the changes that we've put forward. That also means that we can protect the night time cover the Liverpool City Water Fire Stations. Members will recall that that moves to see the downgrade of cover in the evening time. We weren't going to have an immediate available appliance at either of those stations during the evening period. That was going to be brought back into service on a retained basis. The new proposals mean we are able to maintain. It also means we will increase the number of firefighters from 620 to 642. It will actually be 662 because we've got 20 individuals who will be in training at any particular point in time over the next 5 years. But ultimately, the establishment figure will move from 620 to 642. Again, to re-emphasise the point, there's no fire and rescue service in the UK who are suggesting increasing the number of firefighters. There's no fire and rescue services in the UK who are increasing the number of fire engines at this moment in time, given some of the austerity challenges. Yeah, we know that we need to find money to be able to facilitate that, and we're being quite clear and part of the original strategy meetings, and that we reinforce in the strategy day, which is forthcoming. The fact that we are able to utilise our reserves, some underspend, to pay off some of our debt, which will allow us to release revenue in back into the service, which will mean the plans that we are proposing as part of the alternative will be sustainable. This won't be something which we put in place now and then have to remove at a point in time. What it also allows us to do is increase the number of individuals within our protection teams. Again, members, if you pulled over the Merseyside report and the first tranche and second tranche of the inspection report, what it will have identified is shortcomings in every fire and rescue service in the country in regards to their protection capabilities, in down to the number of people that they employ. And these proposals see an increase in those numbers by 5 protection officers, but also a fire engineer who will look at the more complex buildings that exist across the Merseyside area. So those things combined mean we are ultimately moving from the ability to provide 26 fire engines to 30 fire engines. We increase the number of firefighters from 620 to 642. We are maintaining nighttime cover at Liverpool City and Wallasey, and we are increasing the number of protection staff. All in all, that means we will be providing a better response to the public than previously been proposed as part of the original IRMP. And again, on the basis of high level of performance through the service delivery plan, an absolutely endorsement from the HMI inspectors in regards to our performance, and then for the first time being able to present to members of the fire authority proposal which she increases in the number of fire engines and the firefighters, I think is probably a first for me, and a first for the authority, as I say, for at least 10 years. I won't go into any details other than to say contained also within the proposals are some additional proposals which are just about the kind of government service, things like improving our technological response to things like IT improvements, getting information from the members of the public and utilising that information a little bit more effectively. They are the key elements that share, so I'll have a report at that point. I'm happy to take any questions.
The financial implications. We're discussing the last budget, obviously, the last one of the members, and will be discussed at the strategy day.
Yeah.
Not the day. It's on the little card.
Firstly, I just want to welcome James. I think it's a really positive to avoid, particularly increased protection staff, and I think it's obviously had a well support of the community, which is important. So I think that's really positive. I did just want to address the financial thing because, as I say, as a new member, I appreciate I've missed previous conversations around this, but I just want to kind of ask the question, are we kind of happy as much as we can be that we're not kind of going to cause problems later down the line in terms of not just moving any savings we have to find later? Like, are we kind of happy that we're confident we're going to be able to find a way to fund this and make it sustainable, basically?
I think if we take the members back, and I'll refresh it, part of the strategy, we set some principles, and principles being driven by the public, some of the consultation events we've held for number of years now have defined the things which are important to the public, and we've re-established them in regards to the authority position, and come up with a sustainable model moving forward is one of those key principles. So there's nothing that I'm presenting to you today that we can't continue to deliver based on the finances and the kind of plans that we have in place. Without going into specific details, what I would say is Merseyside has quite a significant amount of debt. It has some fantastic facilities, by the way, so some of our stations are the best in the country, but they're being funded through a number of mechanisms, PFI and so on and so forth, so you have to repay that debt. We can see you've got some pension deficit legacy and so on. But we also have a high level of reserves, and we know actually in delivering these plans, we won't deliver them overnight, they will take a period of time before we move from 620 to 642 firefighters, because people are retiring. Working really hard to replace them. But there will be an underspend associated with that movement. So taking the underspend and some of our reserves and utilising that to pay off debt means we are able to release probably about £1 million of what I perceive to be a £1.3 million challenge. Your £300,000 then will be facilitated through all the changes that we will make organisationally to deliver the necessary savings, which will mean that this plan, not only is it an improvement in firefighters will be sustainable in the long term. I caveat that with things change, but as we see it now, this is a real opportunity for us to reinvest in service. If changes from government, more austerity comes, things happen, all we would be is in a similar position to every other fire and rescue service in the country. We don't seize this opportunity now, in my view, we'll have missed the opportunity to increase the number of fire engines and firefighters. Members will be aware of some of the things that I've said previously about planning assumptions. Funny enough, Jackie referenced 20 appliances and said you had had three events where we had 20 appliances. When you look at the people who were in a car park fire, we had 25 engines there. So having 35 appliances is really important to us. That means that we are able to manage a large and contact incident or spate conditions, but also protect our life risk response. So again, members will recall we've talked on 10 key stations previously. So what we are basing our modelling on is that 35 engines, 20 had a particularly large protracted incident at any one point, and the other 10 protecting life risk across Merseyside. Where we wouldn't want to be is having a smaller number of fire engines, a considerable number of them deployed to an operation incident, and an inability to protect life risk in Merseyside. So that is the basis of the plans, as is the kind of change which is reflective of emerging risk, so risks that we have talked about previously, and heightened terrorist threat, and so on and so forth, changing in the environmental conditions, going to more floods, we're certainly going to more hot weather incidents, so fires, winter hills, that'll work more. These proposals reflect the changing in emerging risk, which is directly affecting the Merseyside. So I am absolutely thrilled to be able to present these to the authority. I'm actually thrilled that the authority has supported proposals, certainly subject to the public consultation and certainly even government today, which means that for the first time in a long time, we are reinvesting in the services of Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service.
At the budget meeting, these questions were asked. Could you, or the Treasurer, give us comfort that there will be mechanisms to enable us to achieve this transition, because it is moving money from debt payment and those sort of things into frontline expenditure, and I don't see any sort of explanations or frowns that indicate that there's any problem with the issue that there are mechanisms that can be used. Like everything else in local government, we have been starved for cash. And we could do a lot more, we could be a lot safer. Buildings wouldn't burn down and people losing their jobs and being injured and so forth if we could get there faster with a greater weight and speed. So tomorrow something could happen that knocks our budget off course. But as we sit today, there are machines and mechanisms that will be in place to enable us to make this transition.
Yeah? Just a clarify if it helps, currently in our revenue budget, we've got about £7 million committed to service historic debt. That reason is £1 million is used to pay what we call the local government pension scheme deficit. We have to pay £1 million a year for the historic deficit position. So we just take that one as an example. Every 3 years, the actuary reviews the position on the LGPS. And if the assets increase in value and the liabilities remain the same, the fund, can, the overall financial position can change. At the last actuarial review, 2016, the fund was 85% funded. It's likely that when we get the figures for 2019, which will impact on 2021, the fund's going to be 100% funded. So the £1 million that we have currently, half the £7 million to service debt, would in theory be freed up. The other £6 million is used to service historic capital borrowing that we use to build new stations, fire appliances. Our MRP policy, which is what we set aside to repay the debt, we've changed over recent years to say that if there's any underspend because we've delayed borrowing by borrowing internal cash, we've used those revenue savings to pay additional MRP, so we're paying debt off in advance. And that cumulative effect, I'm confident, will free up an element of the £6 million or the £7 million used to service that debt. The only real risk we've got, and I think not to know the answer to it, is what's going to happen in the next spending review period. So post 2019-20, with the Brexit, with potential elections, etc., etc., there's a lot of uncertainty. I think what the Chief referred to, if in the worst case scenario, the assumptions we made about the future settlement proved to be over-optimistic, or the government saves a significant amount of resource from the authority, we can turn the recruitment, a worst-case scenario, we'd rather not, worst-case scenario, we can turn off the recruitment tap because we're going to lose over half our firefighters in the next 5 years. So if we can't afford the 642, we can only afford 630, 620, hopefully not, but we'll just turn off the recruitment and over a few years, get down back to the 620, and we've got a recruitment reserve of £6 million that we can use to smooth out that change. So there's a lot of uncertainty going forward, there's nothing we can do about that, but as the Chief said, this is the right decision to make. If based on all our reasonable assumptions, we can free up that million, it's right probably to be invested in service to add that extra resilience because of all the changing things that we've highlighted about this.
Thank you. And we're the only fire authority doing this. Reinvesting in the front line, and we will. The strategy day is on the 18th of July, so it's only 2 weeks, and we can go through, in more detail. But you have much of the issue there in terms of that sort of top level decision making we need to have.
Chair, only just to say, just pick up on an additional point there as well, which I probably should have said earlier on. What we have committed to do as well is maintain firefighters at our key stations, which again is related to firefighter safety, safe systems of work. Don't get me wrong, we will have a combination of fire and four, the fire and four safe systems of work for the fire and rescue service. And that again, to a great lesson to be flies in the face of some of the other decisions that I've made elsewhere in the country where it's not uncommon for services to be riding with firefighters on some of their appliances, some of their vehicles now. So again, I'm a higher level response, so not only is it better for the public and the community, we are committed to provide five of our 10 key stations and those hosting national resilience assets which require that members in combat.
Yeah, just to say I totally agree with this and fully support it, and it must be give firefighters out there great morale to think that they're moving forward instead of being cut. So we really do support that. Just a bit of clarification, will these two stations stay as safe havens so it will help community safety in the Liverpool city centre?
Yeah, the stations will be safe havens, they'll be HR and port centres, all of our stations will be. And what is Silver Mass is probably my first one, we just had the defibrillator externally fitted on the Silver Mass fire station. So we are now in the process of moving the defibrillator from inside the building outside the building, so it's readily accessible for the community as well. The firefighters who really utilise those facilities, they make community fire stations, they make, there for the community to use. We have community facilities on there and we welcome the community in.
Councillor Roberts.
So, terms of the actual headline changes, we're going to shift from 26 to 30 fire engines. We're going to shift from 620 to 642 firefighters. We're going to retain the nighttime cover at Wallasey and the Bootle City Centre. We're going to ride fires at key stations. We're going to hire a fire engineer. We're going to hire community safety protection officers. I'm going to do it all by paying off the capital debts early and thereby freeing up revenue funds to pay for these additional services. It sounds like a really good idea to me. You know, I can't see any reason why we'd possibly oppose that. On the contrary, it sounds like it would make people in Merseyside all safer. So I wholeheartedly commend this.
I think it's visionary, innovative, it's rooted in knowing what we do and doing more of what we do well, better, more of it. And the genesis was last year appointing a new chief fire officer, a new chief team, senior team, the experience that we've had, working with members, and we've come up with, I think, well, it'll hit the jackpot. It really is a fantastic proposal. We will have to work on it, revise it, work with the representative bodies, all of our staff, and make this work. And the objective is to keep people in Merseyside safer, and I think we all agree that this will do that. So, colleagues, the proposal is to agree issues outlined in this report, and would all members agree to that?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. If anyone needs to leave, fine. Yeah. There's a scrutiny committee forward plan, pages 303 to 312. Janet, do you want to come through this?
So, members, you're aware, those of you who were here in 2018, that we, with your approval, changed our approach to scrutiny across the authority and established not only a specific distinct scrutiny committee for the member boards, you also know that training for both members and officers in appropriate and effective scrutiny that led to different meetings on a very distinct programmed basis. That's resulted in presentations from different departments and some rapid reviews having been done, with a forward work plan devised from the ideas raised through those departmental presentations. The forward work plan is at page 307 onwards. The proposal now is to go to a more generic form of scrutiny, so rather than having specific, distinct areas of scrutiny at these meetings, because you've already gone through that, the forward work plan has come through with lots of ideas that have been put forward by members in terms of the types of things you want to scrutinise, and it's therefore being proposed that a more generic approach is now used so that you can cover all those things, and I'm simply asking you to approve that, members.
So the time scale is laid out there in the graph and the report.
And I was just going to ask it again as well, this is because it's a new member. And given some of the comments that we've already made today about the impact of deprivation on some of the kind of key issues that we see, is it worth trying to add that to the scrutiny? Because I don't know if that will get picked up elsewhere, worth adding to the scrutiny agenda.
If I may, just to pitch in, we've got one there which relates to the impact of prevention activity. I think if we are able to, we'll be confident in that particular area, so we'll focus on how we're preventing these adverse impacts out of the threat and associated with economic deprivation.
Whilst we bring this report here, what we're trying to do is to make allow the scrutiny committee to own its own agenda. And if you want to raise, if you're on scrutiny or you want to raise this in scrutiny, sure that would be perfectly well received.
That's it. And the other comment I would make is, based on the comments that have been made today, we will take a look at family-friendly policies to include maternity, adoption, fertility treatment, and so on, so forth, and bring those policies back for members to scrutinise based on what happens around the region.
Chair, I was only going to just try to reassure members that the terms of reference for every committee on this authority has a provision in it for references to scrutiny. So any member on any committee at any time can put forward ideas for scrutiny on top of those that are already in the forward work.
Thank you. So is this report agreed? It is agreed. Yes, it is. Thank you. So that's the, other than the date for the next meeting, all of which is on the little card. The next, interestingly, this afternoon at 6 p.m. tonight. 6 p.m. I think it is. Whatever. Maybe 6:30 is the presentation to our cadets. And if any members would like to come back, stay, come back for that. That would be appreciated. The strategy day is on the 18th. The next authority is the 17th of October. We've got a tour round the fire stations next, Eccleston next week, I think that is, the 9th. Again, I would recommend that to members to attend. With all that, Nick, did you want to? Well, I thought I heard you sort of saying you'd come in. No, with all of that, if there's nothing else, I thank you for attendance. Take this good news back to your own authorities, move the resolutions at the councils, and try and get the word out to the public that they are living in the safest part of England, if not the UK. And at that point, I thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair.